chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. We are going to continue to praise you this morning. Your heart and lead. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you.
I want to read a few verses before we go into our final song for this morning. The book of Revelation, chapter 5. The apostle John writes and he says, "Then I looked again and I heard the voices of thousands and millions of angels around the throne and of the living beings and the elders. And they sang in a mighty chorus, 'Worthy is the Lamb who was slaughtered to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing.' And then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea. They sang, 'Blessing and honor and glory and power belong to the one sitting on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever.' And the four living beings said, 'Amen.' And the 24 elders fell down and worshiped the Lamb." Now, the Lamb there is representative of Jesus Christ, and he is the only one worthy to receive our praise and all glory and all honor. And we're going to declare that in this final song that we're going to sing today, declaring that he is worthy. He alone is worthy. Is all creation groaning? Is a new creation coming? Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave,
is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of our blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And does Jesus our Messiah hold forever those he loves?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again? Is anyone whole? Oh, is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of our blessing?
Church. I just want to apologize to Janelle because I messed her up. I was the reason why she said 1 6-year commitment, because I was going like this because I couldn't remember if she had mentioned that we're the standard of what we're asking is a 6-month commitment, but they're also within those 6 months we're shooting for people only serving once in that month. Did she mention that? Okay, so that's what we're looking for. So Yes. I mean, if that is what the Spirit is speaking to your heart, that is some awesome dedication, and it is also prophetic in the sense that we will be here 6 years from now, which we will. But real quick before I forget, hey, happy Thanksgiving to you guys. I know I won't see some of you guys. I'll see some of you, but I won't see all of you guys. So I'm just wishing you guys a happy Thanksgiving. I hope you have a blessed one with your family or whoever you gather with. Also to our online family, happy Thanksgiving. This morning we are finishing our series for the season entitled Give Thanks. And so if you've been with us, you know this already, but it's a series that's founded on 1 Thessalonians 5, where it says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. And so whether it's Thanksgiving or not, as Christians, we are commanded by God, we are instructed by God to be thankful people. So no matter where you are, no matter what you have, no matter what you're going through, we are to be thankful. And I'll admit, as I've shared many times through this series, that's not always easy. Life is tough. Many times we have worries. Many times we have circumstances going on in our life that really, as we talked about last week, that make life stink. And so it's hard to be thankful in those situations. But we have spent the last month searching God's word for answers on how to do that, how to be thankful, even when we may not want to be thankful. And so if you've missed any of those messages, as always, they are available to you. If you log on to our Facebook page, River Church Glastonbury, you can find the live streams recorded there as well. On our website, we have the YouTubes available on the website. So today's message is going to be this. It's going to be, I'll give thanks, and John has so strategically and beautifully crafted the worship set to follow this theme, but we are going to give thanks because God is worthy. Amen? All right, so out of all the things that we've talked about so far in this series, this may be the most important one of them all. And so we should, especially as Christians, we should be thankful because of who God is. And so to help us understand this, if you have your Bible or your Bible app, would you open up to Psalm chapter 138? And then if you don't have either of those, there is a Bible available for you in the back. If you need one, raise your hand and someone will bring one to you. Or you can follow along on the slides behind me. But this Psalm, Psalm 138, is a short but very powerful psalm that was written, or at least attributed, to King David. And it's actually the last psalm that is attributed to King David. And so in this psalm, it appears that David, as he's writing, he has just come to a greater understanding of who God is. If you will, David has leveled up. So in his mind, he knew, or he thought, I knew God was worthy before, but now, because of what I just experienced, I really know God is worthy, and so I'm going to worship him. And so that's really the context of this psalm. And so in that worship, David gives thanks. In fact, the psalm is only 8 verses long, but in the 8 verses, he mentions giving thanks 3 times. And so it's something very important, something he wants us to pay attention to. And so he doesn't really tell us what brought about this greater revelation of God's worthiness, but he does declare to us in these 8 verses wonderful things about who God is and why he is giving thanks to him. And so my hope is that after this morning, we too will walk away with a fresh and greater understanding of who God is, and that he is worthy, and that we should give thanks to him in all circumstances. And so if you have your Bible open, starting in verse 1, David writes this. He says, I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise. I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted above all things your name and your word. If you received a bulletin and you'd like to take notes on the bulletin, once again, I've listed 5 fill-in-the-blank points for you to follow along with. And so if you enjoy doing that, and if it helps you remember what we're talking about, point number 1 is this. God is perfect. God is perfect. David starts out this psalm with, I'll give thanks to you, God, with my whole heart. I'll sing praise to you, or I will worship you. I'll give thanks to your name. In the verse, the phrase, with my whole heart, it refers to being in a state of mind where you're just all in. Like, I am completely committed. David's like, God, you have won my heart, and I am totally with you. Everything that I am, everything that I have, I give it to you. I am all in. And then he says that I'm going to sing to you. And the word that's actually used for sing here is a word that's used to be, to describe being overwhelmed to the point of not caring about anything else that's going on. It's like, I don't care about who's looking. I don't care what anyone else has to offer. I am so consumed with the presence of God and who God is that I must cry out from my heart with a song about how worthy he is. I think of the story of the sinful woman in Luke chapter 7. Some of you may be familiar with that, but in that story, Jesus is invited to a religious leader's house, a Pharisee's house, and while he's there, a sinful woman, I'll just leave that description of her that way because we have kids in service, but a sinful woman comes into the house because Jesus is there. And when she experiences Jesus, when she is set before Jesus, she is overwhelmed with who he is, that he is God in the flesh. And the Bible says that she begins weeping and washing Jesus' feet with her tears and with her hair, and then she pours expensive oil on his feet as an act of worship. Now, here's the thing. She is not supposed to be there. She's not supposed to be there. She does not belong in that house. And so the Pharisee, the guys whose house it is, and he probably had his buddies with him too, they would have all been thinking, how dare she come into this house, into this holy person's house. As she walked in, you bet there were people like, oh, what's she doing here? Why did she walk in? Get out of here, you disgusting person. You don't belong here. That's what the people would have been saying about her. At least, even if it was in their mind. And I think the woman knew that, but she didn't care because she saw Jesus. And once she saw Jesus, nothing could distract her or stop her from worshiping, even if people were shouting shouts of disgust towards her. Now, I'm wondering if you have ever experienced being overwhelmed by God's presence like that, where you have experienced God's presence and you get to the point where you do not care about anything else that's going on except that you want more of God. And in that moment, you are like, God is worthy, and I must sing to him right now. I cannot stop myself. The only thing I care about is giving him thanks. The only thing I care about is worshiping him. I remember the very first Good Friday service that I ever attended after I gave my life to Christ. And so it was held at San Diego State University, and they have an outdoor arena. And so we were all gathered down there, and it was kind of cool because Shane and Shane, I don't know if you guys know who that is, but they were leading worship for that Good Friday service. And so I mentioned that just so you know, like, hey, it was at the very least, quality worship. Like, it was good stuff going on. Now, I also have to admit, at that time, worship or the music part of church was my least favorite part of church. As a new Christian, like, I wasn't all about, like, I didn't know all this Christian-y stuff. I didn't know how to be a good Christian. I didn't know what I was supposed to like, what I wasn't supposed to do. It was all new to me. And I knew, like, I liked hearing God's word. There was something that it like fed my soul, and it was good. And I was like, I like that, but like the singing stuff, I'm really not into like this. Like this is not my preferred style of music. You know, I just wasn't into it. And so I was totally that guy who came in at 25 after, you know, right before the announcements come in. Some of you guys are like, ooh, that's me. I'm sorry. I've been up a long time. My filter is not there. But at that Good Friday service, something clicked for me. As I heard the music wash over me, as I thought about the words that were being sung, I was overwhelmed by the thought of God's worthiness. And I did something that I had never done in my life. As I was engaged with the worship, all of a sudden my hands started going like this. And then wings sprouted out of my, I lifted my hands in worship. Why? Because like David, at that moment, what had clicked in my mind is I realized that I was all in. I was all in. I was experiencing God, and I was beginning to know the worthiness of him. And because of that, I had to cry out from my heart in unabandoned worship. And this was the way that, like, I saw everybody else doing it. I'm like, this means I surrender. And so I surrender. And I began to worship in a way that I'd never worshiped before because of who God is. Now, David, in this verse, he goes on to say, I give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness, for you have exalted above all things your name and your word. What does that mean? Well, I'm going to phrase it this way. God has a perfect track record. There is nobody who loves like God. There is nobody who is faithful like God. You know, track record, it means a lot. If any of you follow basketball now, I'm going to tell you in advance, we have switched from football season to basketball season, and so now some of my stories are going to be basketball-based. But in basketball, there is a current debate going on, at least at the pro level, of who the greatest player is in basketball. And so usually it's a toss-up between Michael Jordan and LeBron James. Now, there is one main and very legit argument in that discussion, and it's the fact that Michael Jordan's track record is perfect. In the finals, he has not lost. And so LeBron may be more naturally talented, more all-around better player, but one argument that gets thrown out is, hey, Michael Jordan's track record is perfect. He never lost a finals. A track record is important, and God's track record is perfect, and that's what David is talking about here. David's talking about everything, every time, God, you have said you were going to do something, you did it. Every time I've experienced your love, it was good. Nothing compares to God, and it's proven by his track record, because he is perfect. And to expand on this, David then now goes on to list four things that God does perfectly to explain how worthy he is. And so in verse 3, he goes on to say this, on the day I called, you answered me. My strength of soul you increased. Point number 2 is this, God perfectly rescues me. God perfectly rescues me. Verse 3 says, on the day I called, you answered. And I love that. Because church, this tells me, first thing it tells me is that God is real. God is real, amen? And he's not just real, but he also is a God who interacts with us. He interacts with us. And it's not even like this. It's not even like he's not sitting on his throne and be like, here's some breadcrumbs, puny mortals. That's not how he interacts with us. No, it's a real relationship. Like when a child calls to his parents, God answers us when we, as his children, call to him. And so I'm gonna say this. We're church family, right? All right, so I get to be real, right? All right, cool. I got to set it up. Most of the time, when my youngest son calls out to me, it's because he needs me to come and wipe his butt. I said we were family, right? That's real. You guys are parents, you know that that's what happens. At a certain stage, when you hear your name, it's probably that. He calls out to me because he has made a mess and he needs me to help him clean it up. And isn't that kind of like us and God? Most of the time, we make a mess of our lives, and we need him to rescue us. We're sinners. Sin messes up our lives, and we need God to rescue us from our mess, and God is faithful to do that because he is good. When we call to him, he answers us. But check this out. It also says, my strength of soul you increased. Our soul is, if you will, it is the deepest part of who we are. It's actually really who we are. And I love the fact that David phrased it this way because it reminds me that God perfectly rescues us. He doesn't just come and help up our mess. He gives us exactly what we need. And the best way that he rescues us is by sending us Jesus. Jesus is the perfect rescue for all our souls. He is what we all really need. We don't really need more money. We don't really need physical healing. We don't really need a better job. What we really need is Jesus. Because when we have Jesus, the strength of our soul, who we really are, what we really need deep down is increased. It's strengthened. Jesus is our perfect rescue, and God is always faithful to rescue us that way through his son, Jesus. Psalm 138 goes on to say this, verse 4. All the kings of the earth shall give you thanks, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth. And they shall sing of the ways, they shall sing of the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he knows from afar. Point number three is this: God has perfect hospitality. God has perfect hospitality. David says, all the kings of the earth shall give you thanks, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth. When I read this, my question was this: how did the kings of the earth hear God's word? Better yet, why would they give him thanks? Well, think about this. What position did David have? What was he? He was a king, that's right. He was a powerful king at that. And so how did the kings of the earth hear God's word? It's my belief that David is the one who told them. He was an influential king, and he used that influence to talk about God. And so what I believe we are seeing here is David is talking about how he is sharing his faith with his peers. He's a king. He talks to other kings about Jesus, or not about Jesus yet, but about God. But here's what I really love. As David shares his faith, he's got faith to believe that the same God that transforms his life will transform their life. He's like, let me tell you about my God. And then internally, he's like, and I believe after you hear about him, he's going to become your God too. Because he's going to transform your life the same way that he transformed my life. And you are going to be singing to him right next to me one day. He had faith to believe that. That all the kings of the earth would hear God's word and that they too would begin singing praise to God and giving him thanks. And I love that. But what made David so confident that that would happen? Well, I believe it has to do with this. I believe it has to do with the fact that God is perfectly hospitable. What do I mean by that? I mean that he knew that God's door was always open. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter where you come from. It doesn't matter what you've done. You are welcome in God's house, and David believed that. It's a thing where we say, come as you are. But even now, as we invite people into the kingdom, we still hold that view. We're like, come as you are. But we also got to warn people that come as you are, but you may not leave as you were. Why? Because God changes lives, and David believed that. He believed that, hey, when you hear God's word, when you experience him, you're going to be changed, and you too are going to be singing his praise. God transforms lives. He rescues lives. And the same thing is for us today. When we should be inviting people, but we should also believe that when they meet God, they're going to be transformed too. And that the people who once thought that we're weird because we sing to an invisible God, that we give so much of our hard-earned money to his kingdom, that we dedicate so much of our free time to serving him, that when they meet God too, we should be believing that, you know what, they're going to find themselves right next to us one day. I know I did. I used to mock Christians. And now I'm here. Like, what am I doing here? Well, I met God, and he transformed my life. When I encountered the presence of God, I experienced his transforming love, and then I too began to give thanks to him and sing of his ways. And so I believe this is a challenge for us, at least in application form, that if we believe God saves, if we believe that God truly changes lives, then we should invite people into the kingdom with the same confidence that David had. We should be like, hey, come meet Jesus. Come, he wants to meet you. You should come meet him, and you'll never be the same, and you'll never be the same in a good way. Now, the only thing that keeps someone out of God's house, since we're talking about hospitality, we do find it in verse 6. Verse 6 says, "For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he knows from afar." Let me say it this way. This is saying that everybody can come in, even the lowest of low, but the only people who can't come in are the haughty or the prideful. Well, why can't the prideful come in? I thought God was perfectly hospitable. I thought he welcomed everyone. Well, yes, he is, and yes, he does. But when it says, when we're talking about the haughty not coming in, we're talking about the prideful not coming in, they're not coming in not because God doesn't want them to come in. God wants everybody to be saved. God wants everyone to be brought into the kingdom. Jesus talked about a parable. He's like, hey, they don't want to come in? Well, look, go invite. My house has to be full. Go invite people in the highways and the byways. Go invite. I want everybody to come in. But the reason why they don't come in is because the prideful don't want to come in. The prideful say, I'm good. I don't need that. I don't need that change. I don't need that Jesus. And so they don't come in. And so maybe we know some people like that. Maybe you find yourself in that way right now. Maybe you're listening online and you find yourself in that kind of mindset. Well, let me just encourage you to not lie to yourself. Don't keep yourself out of God's kingdom. Repent and turn away from your old lives and run into the loving arms of the Savior, because he is perfectly hospitable and he will welcome you into his home. Again, the only thing that's going to keep you out is when you say, I don't need it, when you're prideful, when you're haughty. Now, verse 7 goes on to say, though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand delivers me. Point number 4 is God perfectly cares for me. God perfectly cares for me. Look at verse 7. David's like, God, you always take care of me no matter the trouble I'm in. You keep me alive no matter who is coming against me. You save me from their wrath. But what's awesome here is the phrase, your right hand delivers me. How many people have ever had a job where you have to work a shift? You know, every place got that one person. You got to work a shift with that one person who you know doesn't care. And you're like, man, I got to work a shift with that guy or that gal. Or students. When the teacher assigns group assignments and she gets to pick and you get paired, Jonathan knows, look at that. You get paired with that one student who never does his part. You guys know, some of you guys know that. Some of you guys are that student. Don't be that student. Don't be that kid. But you guys know, whether it's at work or whether it's at school, it stinks to be paired up with a person who gives a subpar effort, with a person who doesn't care. But you know what? That's never God. That's never God. God is perfect. He always gives his best. He always perfectly cares, and that's shown by the phrase that I just mentioned. In Scripture, when it talks about the right hand was the place of power. And so what David is saying, he's like, God, you always perfectly care for me, and you always give me your best all the time. You always give me the best effort. And God does that because that's who he is. He always gives his best. And I think that's perfectly seen in the person and the work of Jesus Christ. If you look at John 3:16, you guys know it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only, somebody say only, He gave his only son that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, I can't remember who shared this with me. It was recent. But notice how it says his only son. God doesn't have two sons. He's got one son. I have three sons, and I love you guys. You guys are my church family, but I ain't sacrificing any of them for you. I'm sorry, but I'm not sorry. Even if I sacrifice one, and I know, like, oh, I've got two left, I can make more. It's not going to happen. I'm not sacrificing any of my sons for you. So it's a good thing that I'm not God. But God had only one son, one perfect son, and he sent that son to earth to die in our place on the cross. God gave us his best. And he always gives his best because he perfectly cares for us. Psalm 138:8 finishes up this way. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands. Point number 5 is this. God sees me as perfect. God sees me as perfect. Now, I'm not saying that we are perfect. I'm saying God sees us as perfect. And what I mean by this, I'm going to mention a few things. But one is that the world can beat us up pretty badly. You know, maybe we don't look the right way. Maybe we don't do things the right way. Maybe we don't come from the right neighborhoods. And that's not to mention the spiritual warfare we face, whether you realize it or not. But the devil is constantly telling us, you are trash. You're not worthy. You're not worth it. You're not valuable. You're trash. But when God sees us, he sees beauty. He sees his most precious creation. Someone who is so valuable, he is willing to send his only perfect son to die for you. And what I also mean when I say that God sees us as perfect is that when we are willing to put our faith in Jesus Christ, meaning that we are willing to believe that Jesus died on the cross for our sins and that God raised him up from the dead 3 days later, when we put our faith in that, that God perfectly forgives all of our sin. And because of Jesus, because we are in him, we are made perfect. The Bible calls that justification. We are made perfectly right in God's eyes because of our faith in Jesus. Now, what I also mean by that is that God sees us according to who he created to be. When God looks at you, he doesn't see the person who is always late. He doesn't see the person who, not you guys. I mean, if the Spirit's not just, but he doesn't see the person who always messes up, the person who never does, you know, he doesn't see all of our mistakes, especially when we're in Christ. What he sees is the person that he's calling us to be, who he has created us to be. Because God has a purpose for our lives. And here's the cool thing. God, even if nobody else does, God believes in us. David got this because he said, the Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. He's like, I know God believes in me. And he's like, God, you keep on loving me because you see me as who you created me to be. And then he's like, thank you so much. And even when it says, like, Lord, do not forsake the work of your hands. It's not talking about like, oh, well, God, maybe this means that God can abandon us. That's not what this verse is talking about. It's actually the way that it's phrased in the original language more has it's more about, God, I don't want this to ever change. What am I experiencing from you? The fact that you fulfill your purpose in my life, the fact that you are always loving me, may that never stop. That's what David's talking about. And so there is a reason why you are alive. God created you for a purpose, even if your parents said you're not an accident to God. There is a purpose for your life that perfectly fits into his plan to not only save this world, but bring glory to his name. And isn't it good to think about the fact that God sees you, or God sees us, or God sees me that way. The fact that the King of Kings, the Lord of all creation, looks at you and says, "You're beautiful. You're perfect. And I created you for something wonderful. And that I believe in you." You know, I'm sorry with the basketball analogies, but it's not in my notes, so I didn't mean to do it. But it's like, right now I'm coaching basketball. I've switched over to that. And one of the coolest things is to see, like, these kids, like, when you give them a compliment or when you teach them something and they do it for the first time, and you're like, "That's exactly what I'm talking about. Like, yeah, I knew you could do it. Like, and I got these plans for you. Like, I see your potential and what you could do in this sport, and this is how I'm going to use you, and I'm gonna make a play." Like, I got one kid who's, like, really good at basketball, and I made an isolation play. If you know what isolation play, that means when everybody gets out of the way and it's, like, one-on-one. And so this kid, he's got a lot of potential, and I'm like, "Hey, man, I got a play for you. And you know what? We're going to call it Order 66. If you guys don't know what Order 66 is, go look it up on Star Wars, but it's like I'm calling it that because I'm like, game over. Like, when you face this kid by yourself, the other team's done. I'm saying all of that because it's like I was infusing into him the fact that I believe in you. I believed in him, and his, like, face lights up, and he's like, it's just a great feeling to know that somebody believes in you. And for us, we can know that God believes in us, that we're not trash, we're valuable. And no matter how we're gifted, no matter what our background is, God has a purpose for us. And so as we close, I'm going to invite the worship team forward. And I got three things. First off, as we head into this Thanksgiving week and even beyond, let's remember to give thanks. Let's give thanks first and most importantly because God is worthy, because he is perfect. But also, maybe you're here this morning and you need a perfect God in your life. You feel like, "Man, I got to be rescued, but I need to be perfectly rescued, or I need to be perfectly cared for." Or maybe you feel lost and you're like, "Man, I would love to be invited into a perfect home." If that's you in any way, call on the name of Jesus this morning. Don't be prideful. Don't keep yourself out of his arms, but rather run into it and cast all your worries at his feet. Because I guarantee you will find a perfect God with perfect love when you do that, when you call upon the name of Jesus. And then, as Janelle mentioned during the announcements today, after service, we are having a ministry fair. Again, as I talked about, God created you with a purpose. And I believe that the greatest purpose for us is to be on mission for God and to be using our time and our gifts and our resources in our local church. And so if this is your home church, let me just remind you that God believes in you, that he has chosen you, and that he has gifted you. And the reason why you're sitting in this place is because God called you to this church, because he's got a plan, a special way that he wants to use you. And when you're not using that gift, things aren't working the way they're supposed to be. We need you no matter what your gift is. And so go and pray. Pray first, and then go check out, get information, and then sign up, even if you don't know your gifts. I started after I got saved, like, I didn't know, like, "Oh, what's your spiritual gift?" I was like, "What's that? I don't know what that means." But I knew God wanted me to get involved. So one day I heard the pastor say, "Hey, we need greeters." By the way, we do need greeters. But I was like, "Well, I don't always smile. So, like, am I the best greeter?" But I was just like, "Okay, they need it. They have a need. I'm going to sign up for it." And I loved it. God grew me in that. And it wasn't like the ministry that I stayed in. But, like, I'm saying all that to encourage you to just, if you're not serving right now, just know that God wants you to be serving. You're important. We need you here. We value you here. And he believes in you, and he values you. And so get involved. Do something around here, because it makes a difference. And so this today is the perfect opportunity to begin walking in that purpose. And again, it's once a week for 6 months commitment. Maybe you sign up for something, and at the end of 6 months, you're like, "This is not what I'm supposed to be doing." That's fine. We're good with that. but at least you're beginning the process and you're trusting God and beginning to serve.